In a previous video, we ventured into the back bays of the Groundbreaker and retrieved radiator parts for Junlei Tennyson. At the end of that quest, Junlei told us that another member of her engineering team, Edna Ingmeyer, needed our help with something. We find Edna just outside of Junlei's office.
You aiming to send a message? If so, we best do it now while we still got time.
Is that what you do here on the Groundbreaker? Relay messages?
Well, yeah. The comm center routes all messages within, to, and from the Groundbreaker. We also switchboard most of the message traffic throughout the Halcyon system. Of course, we're about to go dead, so I may be reappropriated to Architect Knows Where doing Law Knows What soon enough.
Uh-oh, that doesn't sound good. Why are you about to lose your communication capabilities?
Our primary relay station's soon to be occluded by a gas giant. Happens every 40 years or thereabouts. The event's forecasted to last for months, during which we'll lose signal to the station. We've got backup auxiliary relays, but the one currently in orbital range went offline some months ago. We can't spare people for routine maintenance.
Well, can't the board just handle the messages?
Sure. I mean, they got their own relays and all, but they'll only send along messages the corporations pay for. And then they charge folks to send messages back, often more than they can afford. And none of that money goes to the Groundbreaker. Just tightens the board's grip on our throat.
Oh, that's right. You people don't like associating with the board when you can help it. Can't say I blame you, really. Well, screw them.
Maybe they're good to their people, I can't rightly say. But they're no good for us. Not for Groundbreaker.
But wait a minute, if you only have one relay station down, how is that cutting you off from your entire communications?
Well, we wouldn't be utterly and completely blacked out, but we'd lose the majority of our comm traffic for sure. Ships and colonies on Terra 2 need a clear line from their communications towers to the Groundbreaker for the transmissions to make it through. If it's not clear, they transmit to the closest relay station, which stores the message, then passes it along when our orbits align.
What about the other stations?
The others won't be in orbital range during the occlusion event. Isn't it some law of the universe? The relay I gotta rely on is, of course, the one on the Fritz.
Yeah, talk about inconvenient. Why can't you just get the messages transferred from another ship that's within range of the relay station? Can't ships relay messages to each other?
That they can, and they do. But only between ships owned by the same corporation. No corp will authorize sending messages through a ship owned by a rival. And no corp will relay messages for the Wildcat freighters, not without charging them more than they'll make in a single haul anyway. That's why we're the message hub. The Groundbreaker's neither corporate-owned nor board-controlled. Our comms are neutral.
Well, it sounds to me like it's time to get that station back online.
Yeah, I'm working on it. I finally got the chief to approve the budget for a diagnostic expedition. But allocating the personnel loss for sending a technical team to the relay station keeps getting denied by Junlei. The chief.
It seems a bit irresponsible that you haven't fixed that backup relay before now.
We don't know why it went down or if it's even a hardware-related issue. Getting a team out there takes time and money, neither of which we have readily on hand. And we do have multiple auxiliaries, just they won't be in orbital range during the next few months. Our backup station will be. If it weren't for the occlusion event coming our way, we'd be doing fine as always.
Let's say I go ahead and investigate your relay problem. What's in it for me?
You save my comm center from chaos. I guarantee I'll get the chief to authorize some payment forms with your name on them while you're out fixing the station.
Well, I could check out the relay if you'd like.
I should say no, but why not? Maybe you can figure out why it's offline. I'll send you with an equipment manual. Hopefully we'll get lucky, or I'll get my approval in time. Oh, and I'll need you to retrieve a copy of the relay's backup data. I gotta forward any messages from Earth stored in the memory. Better late than never, eh?
You're telling me that you just let messages from Earth sit in some memory bank on an orbital relay?
It's not like they're in high demand. Most tend to be adverts on new products, meaning only folks in Byzantium can afford them. I'm sure the station's got a stack of junk messages just waiting for me to sort through.
All right, Edna, thanks for the information. I'll be going now. To get to Relay GB-23, we have to return to the Unreliable and use the navigation terminal. The orbital relay is a good distance away from the Groundbreaker, not too far from Olympus and Monarch. When we arrive, we can look out the front window and get a good look at the orbital relay before exiting the Unreliable. Straight ahead, we find a glass wall, on the other side of which looks to be the terminal we have to reach to get the relay station operating again. A door to the south looks like it leads directly into this room with the terminal, but of course, it's barred shut. I should have known. Thankfully, there's two more paths we can choose from, one to the east and another to the west. Heading down the hallway to the west first, we find another sealed door that I sadly couldn't open. However, across from the door, we find some kind of bedroom-kitchen hybrid, with a bed on our right and cooking appliances on our left. There's some bit cartridges, a bypass shunt, and a magpick that we can loot, and on top of the counter, we find the security auto-mechanical manual. I wasn't quite sure what this was at first, but I did read online that there's a way to hack into a terminal inside Relay GB-23 and send the mechanicals into charging. To do so, you need to pass a hack check of 45, but supposedly if you read this manual, that hack check gets dropped down to 30. On the bed opposite the table is a rather spiffy-looking piece of dresswear, the Town and Country outfit. It only grants you 3 armor, but notably, the suit also gives you a skill bonus of +5 to leadership. And finally, on a small, dimly lit desk, we find Frey's journal, a beautiful dream. Last night I dreamed, and it was beautiful. The streets of Byzantium were decorated with crimson streamers that laughed in the breeze. They asked me to take them, to give them to my special ones. I gathered the crimson in my arms and felt so alive, so happy. I turned, and Delilah was beside me. I did not question why my supervisor was there, her eyes so full of the emotions I know she feels, but dares not show at work. I wrapped her neck in crimson, tying it tight as a scarf on a cold day. So beautiful. Then the crimson on her neck opened as a second mouth and began screaming. Screaming. When I awoke, I was scared. The dreams are so real now. And this time I recognized a face. I had to leave work early today. Every time I looked at Delilah, I heard a whisper in my mind about how beautiful she would look, with a touch of crimson on her neck. Her neck. This must stop. This is not who I am. This is not who I will become. I must find help. Okay, now that is creepy. I know what he was describing was just a dream, and I'm not a psychologist, but this definitely sounds like the making of a serial killer. I just hope he was able to find help before it was too late. There's a door at the far end of this room, but it's barred shut, so the only way forward is to return to the first room and head down the hall to the east. There's a locked door at the end of this hallway, and another door on our right. Peering down the hall, we can take out a mechanical guardian before it has a chance to attack. And a combat drone! I gotta say, I'm a big fan of the bolter pistol. It always seems to get the job done. There's some kind of elaborate trap blocking the path, but we can easily get past it by shooting the mines and then jumping over the electricity. We come to a room with an electric transformer and a whole lot of loot for us to grab. There's some purpleberry liqueur on top of a table next to a pickaxe, not quite sure what that's doing here, and some energy cells sitting on a container. Tucked away behind the container is a bin with a landmine! That's 3 landmines already, and we've barely started to explore Relay GB-23. In the northeast corner of the room, we find an opening in the wall that leads into a secret tunnel. There's some loot in here, including a tactical shotgun and some ammo. Looks like someone was using this as some kind of emergency escape route. The tunnel leads to a locked door, but we already know what's on the other side. This was the door that we came to just before we reached the electricity trap and landmines. Anyway, heading back into the room with the transformer, we can read another passage from Frey's journal. This one titled, Escape. I've had to start a new journal. I cannot read my previous entries without the whispers tempting me. The whispers do not stop. Every person I see, the whispers tell me to help, help, help them. They show me the pain and longing hiding in their eyes. They tell me how these people want, no, need, the gifts I can give. All it would take is a few moments with a blade, a bright, bright, bright fountain of crimson to delight the eyes, and all of their pain would be gone. I could do it. I know how to help them. It gets harder and harder to stop myself. I saw a friend today, an old friend from school who's now a doctor for Auntie Cleo. I told him about my dreams. Nothing outright. Oh no, I'm not so foolish as that. I told him it was an old book I'd found, and described my dreams and whispers as happening to a character in the book. I asked him how he'd help this character. He looked at me and he knew. He knew. He knew! The whispers told me to end his pain, that he'd tell. He'd tell! I got up and left quickly. I did not hurt him. Not. I have to leave Byzantium. He will tell. They'll come for me and lock me away. I must find a secret place. A place I can be alone. A place with no whispers. Here you can see Frey's twisted mind at work. The whispers inside his head are telling him that to kill people, or to create a fountain of crimson, as he put it, is to end their pain and suffering. Thankfully, there seems to be a part of him that's still sane, that's pushing back against the whispers. After looting a magpick from behind the transformer, we can duck down and enter another tunnel running through the walls. There's a bin and some weapon parts on our left, and then if we follow the tunnel all the way to the west, we can grab some Adreno from another bin. The tunnel drops us off at another medium-sized room, with several mechanicals milling about. If we're patient, we can take advantage of the explosive canisters. The explosion took down the mechanical with ease, but it seems to have attracted the attention of two more. There's more enemies on our compass, but before we go toe-to-toe with them, we can go ahead and loot the room. And there is a lot of loot here. We find ammo, a bypass shunt, canned salt tuna, purple berry crunch, some supplements and medical supplies, and more ammo. Gosh, I feel like I just won the lottery. To the west, there's also a large bin we can unlock that contains a suit of retrofitted heavy power armor. The power armor gives you a +5 skill bonus to heavy weapons and stealth skills, so it's great for players who want to sneak around one moment and then rush in guns blazing the next. I decided to equip my character with it for good measure. Near to this bin, we find a third entry from Frey's journal. Title, The Source. The whispers have a source and I have found it! Found it! I have taken refuge on an orbital relay station. It's smaller than a worker's hovel, barely a few thousand square meters, but sufficient for my needs. I was able to flee Byzantium with enough bits to purchase supplies to last for decades. It was strange being among common people on the Groundbreaker. The whispers barely stirred at the sight of their ill-fed, scarred, and unwashed bodies. If only there were fewer freighters docking there, bringing real people from Byzantium, I could almost have made a home free of temptation. Free. Free. As I made this place livable, or as much as it can be, I started hearing the whispers from the relay terminal. They told me to listen to the voices traveling through their aether to reach me. Calling out to me to help them, alone, lonely, needing my help. I found a way to power down the transmitter. No more voices in the aether, and no more whispers. They fell silent, silent, silent. This was not me. It's not. I am not this foul thing that I have feared for so long. It was the voices in the aether trying to make me hurt others. I was stronger than they, and I have defeated them. Them. I have already begun making plans to return to my home. Now that the whispers are defeated, I can resume my life again. I can't wait to return. I miss my family and co-workers so much. Especially Delilah. Well, now we know how the communications got shut down. Frey flipped a switch to stop the so-called voices in his head from coming in through the aether. The sad part is, these voices weren't in his head at all. They were real communications coming in to relay GB-23. Can you imagine having a real mental condition whereby you hear voices in your head only to escape to a refuge and hear voices coming in through the communication system? Talk about adding gasoline to a fire. Poor Frey. I hope he made it back home safe. There's a door leading out of this room to the east, but this just brings us back into the room with the transformer. Instead, we can head up some stairs, where we meet the janitor Mechanical, complete with a duster in place of a right hand. The janitor was charging in my playthrough and never attacked, though I'm not sure if he attacks at all. Can't imagine how much damage a robot janitor could do, though. No offense to the janitors in the audience. There's a small bathroom near to the janitor, but not much here. And after making our way into another room to the north, we're forced to deal with a few more Mechanicals. Looking around, we notice that this is the room we saw through the glass wall when we first entered Relay GB-23. Against the wall to the east, we find Frey, cold and lifeless, with a pistol in his hand. Next to his body is the final journal entry. Forgive me. I was so wrong. 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 The whispers did not stop. Not. Not. They have returned. They howl. Howl. Howl at me. Demanding I return home and bathe the streets in crimson. Bright crimson. Beautiful crimson. I can only think of one way to end this. End. End. Forgive me, Delilah. And so ends the tragic tale of Frey. Realizing that he was a danger to those he loved most, he did the only thing he could think of and took his own life. I suppose it's an honorable thing to do, but no less sad. But maybe there's a beacon of light in all this darkness. Maybe we can take solace in the fact that Frey died a decent man, having never succumbed to the horrific things the voices were telling him to do. Rest easy, Frey. On his body, we can loot the relay control terminal passcode, which we'll use in a moment to get the communications back online. We also find a one-handed weapon called the silencer. This weapon looks absolutely terrifying, with three rotating blades attached to the end. Talk about overkill. It has a bleeding effect and deals 214 damage per second. And if it's modified with the speed grip, it also grants plus 15% to melee weapon attack speed. I tried out the silencer on a few marauders in Emerald Vale, and let me tell ya, this thing makes short work of them. When its condition is at 100%, I was easily taking down marauders with just one swing. The silencer is probably the best melee weapon I've seen in the game yet, and I could see myself using it quite a bit throughout the rest of the game. That's saying something too, coming from someone who typically prefers to use ranged weapons. After looting Frey, we can head over to the terminal and use the relay control terminal passcode to activate the relay transmitter. With that, we can head through a barred door to the west, travel through the room we explored first with the bed, and then board the Unreliable to return to the Groundbreaker. We find Edna where we left her, inside the engineering department.
My comm center already got an update ping from the backup relay. I trust everything went smoothly.
Well, smooth enough, anyway. Here's your data backup.
Thanks. That's odd. The only messages in the queue are encrypted ones. Looking at the transmission logs, the relay hasn't received a single unencrypted message in the past 36 months. Must be on account of some new security red tape. Well, whatever's the cause, the board and the Earth Minister will see it sorted. Thanks again for saving my derriere. I secured quite the payment authorization for you from Chief Jun Lei. Try not to spend it all in one place.
For completing this quest, we gain experience and 1200 bit cartridges. Now, mind you, I've been moving through this game at a snail's pace. The only locations I've explored thus far are Emerald Vale and the Groundbreaker, because I want to make sure that I cover every ounce of lore that the Outer Worlds has to offer. That being said, I'm not sure whether we'll get to learn more about Frey as we continue our playthrough, but I really hope that we do. There are still so many unanswered questions. Who was Frey anyway? Who was this mysterious Delilah woman he kept referring to? Why do people from Byzantium seem to trigger the voices inside of Frey's head? After all, he did mention that he would have been perfectly fine living the rest of his life here on the Groundbreaker had it not been for, quote, real people from Byzantium docking their freighters here. In my opinion, Obsidian would be missing out if they didn't expand upon this story. But what do you think? Do you have any theories as to why Frey was hearing evil voices inside his head? Why do people from Byzantium trigger his psychotic episodes? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. I post new videos on the Outer Worlds every Wednesday and Sunday, ladies and gentlemen. So be sure to subscribe and hit that bell notification icon so that you can be alerted when I post new content. If you're so inclined, leave a like on this video too. I'd really appreciate it. I'll be back in just a few days with a brand new video on the Outer Worlds, but that's all I've got for now. Thank you again so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.